All right, Charles, welcome back. So let's see what you've come up with.
Okay. So I would choose for the second one, support vector machines. And the reason why is because there seems to be a single line that seems to be in the middle between where the plus and the minus are. So it looks like it's trying to maximize the margin.
Yeah, though those aren't training points. I'm just labeling the regions.
Oh, never mind. Well, then I totally misunderstood what you're asking us to do. I stand by it.
Yeah, I think that's a perfectly fine answer because a basic support vector machine is going to find a linear separator. And so the output, the classifier that comes out of it, is going to separate any kind of region into pluses and minuses with some line separating them out. That's also true of perceptrons. It's also true of certain kinds of simple neural nets. So all of those seem like they'd be reasonable answers for the middle one.
Oh, okay. Well, then given that, I'm going to say the third one is a nearest neighbors method.
Ah, good. And what nearest neighbor do you think?
K nearest neighbor?
Sure. I was thinking one nearest neighbor.
Yeah, I was too, actually, believe it or not.
One nearest neighbor. So I don't think we got a chance to draw one of these diagrams when we were talking about nearest neighbors, but this is called a...
Voronoi diagram?
Voronoi diagram, right. Because what's happening is it's breaking up the plane into the regions that are closest to some particular points. So
right.
You give it a set of points, it breaks up the plane into things closest to that. And in this particular case, we probably had 3 points, and one was labeled plus, and another one was labeled plus, and one was labeled minus, and so it broke the space up into these sections that way. So Voronoi diagrams can be very aesthetically pleasing. I don't think I drew this one particularly well.
I think it's perfect. My eyes are closed. I think it's perfect. Given that, then I'm going to say the first one is decision trees.
Ah, very good. Because decision trees split things, if you're talking about in a two-dimensional space, it's going to split at the top node in one dimension. And here it looks like that's this split. Then maybe it looks like on the left side, that's a minus. On the right side, there's another split. On the left side of that, it's a plus. On the right side, there's another split into pluses and minuses. You get these sort of interesting nested rectangles. They also can be very pretty,
right?
Very Mondrian-ish. Yeah, very good. So this is not what we're going to talk about today.
Okay, good.